for me to be able to spend this Sabbath with you in this place. And I pray that God will bless us specifically this Sabbath, because as we know, God has special blessings for us every Sabbath when we come into His presence. And I'm reminded of a passage in Testimonies, Volume 2, page 705, where Ellen White was speaking about those people who come into the presence of the Lord to worship in Sabbath. And she said that when the people of God are coming into His presence, as they come and enter the door to worship God, there is an angel who sits at the door. And as they come in, these angels, they pour blessing upon them. Amen. And they are blessed with health and with power, with strength, with everything they need so they can be strong spiritually. So I want to believe that as we come in this Sabbath into the presence of God, we'll richly be blessed by the Word of God. And may God help us to grow spiritually and to come closer to Him. I want us in this morning to study something that I believe is very important for us. We are speaking about Daniel all the week. This was our theme. And what is important about the book of Daniel, what is specific to his book, is that the book of Daniel, it's revealing to us prophecy of the end time. But what I want to talk to you in this morning, it's about the events of these last days. And I want us to see, by God's help, how close are we to the Sunday law decree, and how close are we to the end of this world. And I pray that God will help us as we read the Bible. I want to invite you to open our Bibles in Romans chapter 13. I want us to begin in Romans 13. And we want to read together verse 12. Romans chapter 13 and verse 12. The Bible says, let's begin actually in verse 11. Romans 13, verse 11. And that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The Bible says that the time which we are living now, it's the time when we have to awake out of sleep. And the reason why we have to awake out of sleep is because we are nearing the end of time. We are nearing actually our salvation. Our salvation is nearer now than we first believed. And without even opening the Bible, if we just think of what is the condition of the world today, we can clearly see that we are coming close to the end of this world. We see the events that are taking place around us. We see the immorality, the natural disasters, the strife, and the war that is in the world. We can clearly see that Jesus is coming soon. And we want to understand what does it mean when Paul says it's time to awake out of sleep? What does it mean to awake out of sleep? We want to understand what this does mean, and then we want to understand what it means to sleep also. Let's read verse 12 from the same chapter. We want to see what does it mean to sleep in the time of the end. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. So to sleep in these last days of Earth's history, in this perilous time, it means actually to have the works of darkness in our life. So if you want to wake up of sleep, we need to separate ourselves from sin. This is the message that the Bible says. This is our message actually, and this is what we have to experience. And I want us to understand this morning that we'll never be able to understand prophecy fully until we do not separate ourselves from sin. We have to put away sin in our lives. Only then we'll be able to understand prophecy. But I want us to look again at verse 11. Because the Bible says, knowing the time, you should awake up out of sleep. And I want to say that we cannot awake out of sleep. We cannot change our spiritual condition, except first we understand the time in which we are living. For this reason, I want in this morning, by God's help, to understand where we are in the prophetic syllabus. Where are we in these prophetic events? And why should we wake up now more than ever before? As I'm speaking about this, I'm reminded of a tribe from Israel where the Bible says that these people, they knew the time, and because they knew and understood the time, they knew what they ought to do. Let's read in First Chronicles, we go and read from chapter 12, First Chronicles chapter 12 and verse 32. First Chronicles, in chapter 12, verse 32, the Bible says, "And of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times, to know what Israel ought to do, the heads of them were 200, and all their brethren were at their commandment." So these people, this tribe, they understood the times, and because they understood the times, they knew what Israel ought to do. Do you want to know in this morning what we must do in preparation for the Sunday law, for the crisis that is coming? If we want to understand this, we must first understand the time in which we are living. And I pray that God will help us to see this very clearly in this morning. When Jesus Christ was coming on this earth, when he began to preach, if you go in Mark chapter 1, verse 14, I want us to see that Jesus Christ himself, he was preaching about prophecy and repentance. And these two things, they go together, they are connected. We cannot speak about prophecy without calling people to repentance. And all of us who are here today, we need to have this experience of repentance before it is ever too late. Let's look at verse 14 in Mark chapter 1. The Bible says, "Now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God." Verse 15 says, "And saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel." So when we understand the time in which we are living, this understanding of the times in which we are living will awaken in our hearts a desire to repent. And we'll never repent and come back to Jesus until we do not understand the time in which we are living. These prophecies are given to us in order to help us to come closer to Jesus and to be prepared. So Jesus Christ was preaching about prophecy, and in the same time he was calling people to repentance. And I want us in this morning to have this experience in our lives. As we are going to study in this time, I want us to pay attention to what the scripture has to say about this last day events. And you know, God is so merciful. He did not allow us to be in darkness. He has clearly shown us the events that are going to take place before his second coming. I want to remind you something. As you are studying this prophecy, I want us to see those who are here yesterday morning. We are talking about the disciples. The disciples of Jesus Christ who were falling asleep into the Garden of Gethsemane. And I just want to read you this quote from Testimonies Volume 2 in page 205. I want you to see, what does he mean to sleep in this end time? "The Son of God went away the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And again he came to his disciples and found them sleeping. Their eyes were heavy." By these sleeping disciples, now want us to listen, is represented a sleeping church when the day of God's visitation is nigh. It is a time of clouds and thick darkness when to be found asleep is most perilous. So this is actually what the Bible is saying. When we sleep, we are in a spiritual condition. Actually, we are spiritually dead. Do you remember when Jesus resurrected Lazarus? He was telling to his disciples, "Lazarus is sleeping, I will go to wake him up." And the disciples did not understand. But Jesus was speaking about the death of Lazarus. In the Bible, sleep is likened to death. So when the Bible says that we are asleep, we are actually dead spiritually. And you know, for you to be dead spiritually, you need only one sin in your life, and that is enough to be dead spiritually. Because the Spirit of Prophecy says in Steps to Christ, page 34, that one single cherished sin is enough to neutralize the entire power of the gospel. So if we have one sin in our lives this morning, that will be enough to neutralize the power of the gospel. And we need to cleanse ourselves from sin. This is what the Word of God says. So as you look at these disciples who are sleeping in the Garden of Gethsemane, I want us to remember something. Do you remember what Peter did when he saw the armies coming into the garden? What he did? He just took his sword and he started to fight, actually. Why was Peter start fighting with the sword? This is my question. And the answer is very simple, because this is what Peter practiced all along. He was used to fight with the sword. And when the trial and the crisis came, he did what he was used. So I want us to understand, in this time of preparation, if we watch movies, If we go to whatever places and do whatever things, if we play different things that are not according to God's word. And I also want to mention here something. I do not condemn physical activity or physical exercise. It's very good. But whatever has to do with competition in sports, Ellen White is very clear on this one. She condemns sports activity, especially those sports which make people to compete. This is not the will of God, because there is a verse in the Bible which says you should esteem your brother above you. Mm-hmm. So you cannot do that when you play football, for example. If you esteem your brother, then you have to give him the ball. That will no longer be the football that we play today. So we need to understand what does it mean to follow Christ in everything that we do. And you know, I want to say that whatever we do in this time is extremely important, because everything that we do, even the way we dress, and we may talk about it later on, you know, it's extremely important to pay attention to what the Word of God is saying. Did God give us a counsel in regard to dressing in the spirit of prophecy? Do you know that Ellen White was writing a testimony about it? You find it in Testimonies Volume 1, I believe. It's page 456 to 466. You find an entire testimony about how we should dress. And especially it is referring to women. And you know, it's very important as you come into the presence of God. And the presence of God is all over, not only in this place. It's important to dress properly. And I want to remind you a point. When the priest was going into the most holy place, into the Day of Atonement, did you know that the priest had a special garment for the day? Mm-hmm. He had to change the entire garment, and he put on a garment. And the Bible says, if you read, I don't remember the passage now, the Bible says that as he was going on the stairs, doing the service there, he was not allowed to, I mean, he had to wear something under that his legs may not be seen or even make his private parts. Yes. So the Bible is very clear. We should come in the presence of God with solemnity and modesty, because we are living in the Day of Atonement. I just want us to understand, as this time of crisis is coming, we need a serious preparation today.
Yes, sir.
And I want to give an example. Do you know, if you have a sponge, and you take this sponge and dip it in a glass of wine, if you dip it there and you take it out and you squeeze it, what it will come out? Wine. It will be wine. If you take the same sponge and dip it in water and take it out and squeeze it, what it comes out? It's water. This means that whatever we do in this time, whatever we put in our minds, whatever we practice, when the time of crisis is coming, when the Sunday law is coming, and we are squeezed by these trials, we will reveal what we have practiced today. This is what is going to happen. We cannot do otherwise. So I want us to read now a quote from Testimonies, Volume 7, chapter 141, page 141, where the Spirit of Prophecy speaks about the last act in the drama. I want us to see this passage. It says, "The substitution of the laws of men for the law of God, the exaltation by merely human authority of Sunday in place of the Bible Sabbath, is the last act in the drama." Did you know that for us as Adventists, the clause of probation is at the Sunday law? Because the Bible says this is the last act in the drama. It is our last test by which we can be accepted in the kingdom. So when the Sunday law will come, we will have to confront this test personally. And we're talking about Noah, Daniel, and Job, if you remember. Actually, my message this morning is entitled Noah, Daniel, Job, and the Son of Perdition. This is our message. And I want to see something different than we have seen until now. But it's something that will make you understand how close you are to this event. I want us to go now. And just another point before we enter our study. Let's see what does the Bible say in 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1. And we read verse 19. My question is this. Does the Church of God in these last days, does Laodicea understand prophecy? This is my question. Do we understand prophecy in the last day events? Let's see what the Bible says. Verse 19 says, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts." So this light that shineth upon us, the prophecy of the Word of God, can be understood only when the day star arises in our hearts. My question is, what does this star, day star represents? Let's go to Revelation chapter 22. Revelation 22, we are going to read here verse 16. Revelation 22 and verse 16. The Bible says, I, Jesus, have sent my angels to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. Who is this star? Jesus. The star is Jesus Christ. So only when Jesus Christ will be in our hearts, we'll be able to understand prophecy. So now my question is, where is Jesus Christ in Laodicea? Is he in the heart or is he outside?
Outside.
He's outside knocking at the door. My question is, why is Jesus outside and not inside? Because the Bible says in Romans 3:23, all people have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Where Christ is, there is no sin. And where there is sin, there is no Christ. So the reason why Jesus Christ is not in our hearts is because we have sinned. And not only we have sinned, but we continue sinning. And Christ cannot come in. We must first cleanse our hearts. We must give up every sin. We must leave those sins that we cherish and love so much. We need to be purified, and Jesus will come into our hearts. So if we want to understand the time in which we are living, we need to be purified from every sin. I want us to read Romans chapter 15. As we enter into our message, I want us to see in this morning, I will not hold you over the time that we are having, but I want us in this time to focus our attention on what the Word of God has to say. In Romans 15 and verse 4, the Bible says, for whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the Scriptures might have hope. Whatever was written aforetime, it was written for our learning. So in this morning, we want to understand what are these things for us today. And just for the sake of confirmation of this passage, let's read also 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 11. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 11. We want to see that these things are more for us than for the other people. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 11, the Bible says, Searching what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify, when it testified beforehand the suffering of Christ and the glory that should follow, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things. So these things are more for us today than for them the time. So we have to understand what does the word of God has to say to us in this morning. I want us to go to Ezekiel chapter 14. We read this passage 2 days ago. Ezekiel chapter 14. I want us to be reminded of the experience that Noah, Daniel, and Job had. What was their experience? And we discovered that these people, they actually had the experience of the three angels' message. They experienced the three angels' message in their lives. We want to look at verse 20, Ezekiel 14 and verse 20. The Bible says, thou Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it. As I live, said the Lord God, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter, they shall but deliver their own souls by their righteousness. So when the time of trouble will come, when the crisis is coming, the Bible says, though there will be a lot of people there, and including these people, it's only them who shall deliver their souls. Now, let's go to verse 21. For thou says the Lord God, how much more when I send my four sore judgments upon Jerusalem. I want you to keep in mind these four judgments. Now look at these judgments. The sword, the famine, and the noisome beast, and the pestilence, to cut off from it man and beast. So the Bible says there are four judgments which will come upon Jerusalem. And this is the sword, famine, noisome beast, and pestilence. Now we want to understand what are these four judgments. Because when these judgments fall, we need to have an experience like Noah, Daniel, and Job, and be faithful, have the righteousness that they had in order to remain standing. We want to look in Revelation chapter 6 and see what this represents. Revelation chapter 6, we are going to read from verse 7. I want us to go step by step and understand very clearly what the Word of God has to say. Revelation chapter 6 and verse 7. If we are there, let's read together. And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. Now look at the description. And I looked and behold a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was death, and hell followed him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beast of the earth. So the Bible speaks about a horse, and the horse in the prophecy, it represents something. We want to see what does the horse means in the Bible. Let's go to Songs of Solomon. Songs of Solomon, chapter 1 and verse 9. The Bible tells us what does the horse represents in the Bible prophecy. Songs of Solomon, chapter 1 and verse 9. The Bible says, I have compared thee, O my love, to a company of horses in Pharaoh's chariots. So in the Bible, a horse stands for a woman. And we know clearly that a woman represents a church. So when we study about a horse, we are dealing with a church action. And the Bible says that this horse was a pale horse. But now I want us to look further at the description. It says that and his name that sat on him was called death. My question is, what is death in the Bible? What is death? You know, Romans 6:23 says that the wages of sin is death. So death in the Bible is sin. But my question is, what is sin? Sin is the breaking of the law. 1 John 3:4 says, the sin is the breaking of the law. Now we want to put these things together. This man that sits on the horse, it's a man of sin, and it's a man who breaks the law of God. We may already guess who is the person, but now we just want to look a little bit what it means that he sits on the beast. Let's go to Revelation 17. Revelation chapter 17. We are going to read from verse 1. We want to understand what it means that he sits on the beast. From verse 1 we read in Revelation 17, and there came one of the seven angels, which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, come hither, I will shew unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. We know that Revelation 17 is speaking about the false church. It's about the false church, and it says that this church, this woman actually, sits upon many waters. Waters in the Bible, if you look in verse 15 from the same chapter, it's multitudes, tongues, and people. So when the Bible says that it sits on many waters, it means that it's a religious system which actually leads the entire world. And you know, when you look at this religious system, we think that in Christianity, we think that this religion of Catholics, we think that they are only leading this church, but it's not true. They actually lead the entire world religiously. Did you know that this part of the world, like Muslim, the people from that side, they are actually a religion which was created also by popery. Did you know that? They created all these things because they want to bring confusion. And we are not speaking about people who are separated. They may seem to be separated, but they are united actually. This is what is taking place. And I want us to see something else. When the Bible says that this man sits on a horse, it means that he ruled the church. Not only the church, Romano-Catholic church, but he ruled the entire world, religious world. And not only that, verse 18 in chapter 17 says, and the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth. So what does the Bible say? What does a king mean in the Bible? A king is the one who has what? What? He has dominion and power, but we are referring here to a political power. So this beast, this religious system, it does not only lead people religiously, but also politically. So we find in this morning and discover that this religious system controls the entire world religiously and politically. This is what the Bible says. So let's go back in Revelation chapter 6. We want to see what is happening in this passage. Verse 8 says, and I looked and behold a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was death, and hell followed with him. So the man that seated on this horse represents papacy, this religious system which leaded the entire world religiously and politically. And this power, the Bible says further, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth. And now I want us to listen to the description. To kill with sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with beast of the earth. So I want to ask you a question before you go further. What does it mean that they were given power unto them over the fourth part of the world? Do you know in Revelation 7, the Bible speaks in verse 1 about the four angels who are holding the winds of the world. Yeah. So when these angels will deliver the winds, what is that? What is the time? It will be a time of persecution and a time of strife and of war. So when it says that they are given power over the four parts of the world, it actually means it's a time of persecution. And if you study this passage, it's actually describing the events that took place in the Dark Ages. Mm-hmm. It was the papal persecution that came on those people when they killed, if I'm remembering well, over 50 million, even history says 100 million Christians were killed by them. Now I want to look. If this is what is described here, and we just read in Ezekiel these four judgments that are coming, it means that when Ezekiel was speaking, he was referring to another time of persecution which is going to come upon this world. And this is the last time of persecution. But in that time, we have to experience, to have the experience of Noah, Daniel, and Job. We have to be righteousness. So we want to go back a little bit to Ezekiel chapter 14. I want us to see Ezekiel chapter 14. It's very important for us to understand what the Bible says. Let's read again verse 20. Though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, said the Lord, is as if God is swearing, as I live, says the Lord, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter. They shall but deliver their own souls by their righteousness. So what we need this morning to understand is that we need today to have an experience, an individual experience, which will help us to come into a connection with Christ in such a way that when the time of trouble is going to come, we'll be able to stand. And I believe we all of us want to stand. But you know, though we are together here, I said this the other days, we are not going to stay as a group. We are going to stay individually. That's why we need an experience now that is individual. Mm-hmm. And I want to give an example. You know, when we go to eat, you know, there is nothing like, if I'm busy, let's say, and I want my brother to help me, I cannot say, go brother and eat for me, because I'm busy now. That is not possible, because everyone has to eat for himself. And this is the same thing with the experience we need to have. We cannot have experience for others. We have to have our personal experience with God.
Amen.
This is my prayer that you'll have this experience. So now we want to look at it. We want to understand. This part I want you to be very careful because it's the most important part of the message. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians and chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And we are going to read from verse 1. We just said that man that seated on the horse is called death. We understood that it is the man of sin. Let's see what Paul has to say about this man of sin. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, reading from verse 1. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that he be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letters from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. What does the Bible say? It says that be not soon shaken in mind. Do you know what that means? We can physically be in the Church of Christ. We can physically be Seventh-day Adventist, but we can be shaken of our faith, in our faith. Mm. Actually, we can be present with our bodies in this place, but our minds can be in another place. Mm. And not only that, if we do not have this experience now, when the time is coming, we'll realize that we have been here for nothing. Because if we don't experience the cleansing and purging of sin in our hearts, we'll not be able to make it in the time. And I want us to understand, what does it mean to be shaken in our minds? You know, we have studied about Daniel. And I love that chapter, chapter 3 from Daniel. But I view it in a different way. You know, when these people, they set up that image, that represents Sunday law. You read it in Ellen White, she says that this is the representation of the decree. So now, when people were called to bow down and worship, if someone was to stand by a side and look at this image, you know, when that trumpet sounded and people bowed down, what would you see? You would have seen it as if all the people are bowing down because there were only three people who remained standing. So my question is, it's only these three Hebrew Jews that were among that multitude. The Bible says that they were brought from Jerusalem many more. So I believe there were a lot of Jews there, but they bowed down to the image. You know what that means? Ellen White speaks in a place, I don't even know the page. I think his testimony is volume 4. I have to look for it. It says that when the trial will come and the shaking time is coming, the church will almost fall completely. But it will not fall, it will stand. So when you look at this image and all the people bow down, you could say the church almost was fallen. But it was not fallen. Why? Because there were three young people who remained standing. Amen. So now I want to look at these three young people. I want to believe. I don't want to say that this is what it means, but I want to believe. Why there were not four people standing or five? Why three? Do you know, in the Bible there is nothing like mistake. Nothing by happenstance. When the Word of God speaks something, that is important for us. I believe these three young people, they represent a message which is from three parts. Actually, the three angels' message. And do you know that when the time of trouble shall come, we'll be delivered only by the power of this message. And I want to tell you something else. These three young people standing, I believe they represent the three angels' message. And not only that. What was the next event? They were thrown into a fire. Fire means persecution. But when the persecution commenced and they were in the fire, what happened? It came an angel, or God himself came from heaven in the fire, and by that coming of this angel, all the world knew about the God. So this might be the loud cry. This is how I see the things. Of course, we can understand this from our studies, but I believe that we need to have this experience before it is before the time this time will come. And I want us to see what Paul is saying here. Be not shaken in your mind. You know when this time will come. In Great Controversy, page 608, the Spirit of Prophecy says, the majority of those people who are in the church today, they will leave our ranks and join the ranks of enemy when this time is coming. And there is another passage in Testimonies, volume 5, page 134, which says that it's important for us to stand firm to the Lord when the majority will forsake us. That time is coming, brothers and sisters, and it will not be easy. It seems like all the people of God will leave this church because they are not grounded into the Word of God. So we want to read further on. When this time is coming, let's read verse 3. Now I want us to see the very important thing. Let no man deceive you by any means. Do we live in a time of deception today? Oh, there is deception everywhere. The Bible says, let no man deceive you. And I could stop a little bit here and say something. Actually, let me see if I have this passage with me. I want to read you something very important. I think it's important for us to understand this passage. Yeah, I'll just say it from my memory. You know, in Great Controversy 594, the Bible says that we should always stand for a thus says the Lord. In other words, we should never go by thus says the man. Because man has no authority except he does the will of God. So when the Bible says, let no man deceive you, we don't have to listen to any man in the world. Anyone. And you know, I heard the message yesterday from our brother who was preaching here about what is the condition of our church today. And I believe that the church of God is passing through the most serious time in this period of time. Because we are in the greatest apostasy that was ever. And everyone, when she saw the apostasy, it's called Omega, this was the most dreadful thing that she saw. And it was coming. And in the selected messages, I can actually read this quote to you. Selected messages, volume 1, page 204, the Bible says, the Spirit of Prophecy says, I believe you know this passage. Just to remind you, the enemy of souls has sought to bring in the supposition that a great reformation was to take place among Seventh-day Adventists. And that this reformation would consist in giving up the doctrines which stand as the pillars of our faith and engaging in a process of reorganization. Were this reformation to take place, what would result? The principles of truth that God in His wisdom has given to the remnant church would be discarded. Our religion must be changed. Our religion would be changed. The fundamental principles that have sustained the work of the last for the last 50 years would be accounted as error. We just leave this world today. This is what happened. If you remember 1956, the new theology came in. And we are now leaving the fulfillment of these words. Now listen what is going to happen. A new organization will be established. Books of a new order would be written. And you know, it's hard to find spirit of prophecy in a theological school. I went to our theological school in Romania, in Cernica. This is how the place is called. And I was going into that library. I wanted to see the books. They have 28,000 books of whatever authors. But most of these books, they are written by infidel authors. So these books, they have nothing to do with our message. And if you are looking for the spirit of prophecy, you could hardly find one book. You cannot find it because they don't study spirit of prophecy. They don't even study the three angels' message. I have friends who told me they are not studying it in 4 years. They don't do anything. This is what is happening. And I want us to see something else. A system of intellectual philosophy would be introduced. The founders of this system would go into the cities and do a wonderful work. What they would do? They would do a wonderful work. But wonderful is not enough. We must do the work that God is calling us to do today. Not a wonderful work, which seems wonderful in the eyes of people. The Sabbath, of course, would be lightly regarded as also the God who created it. And we have people who do not call, who are not keeping the Sabbath according to God's word. We need to be reformed even in the way we keep the Sabbath.
Amen.
Nothing would be allowed to stand in the way of the new movement. The leaders would teach that virtue is better than vice. But God being removed, they would place their dependence on human power, which without God is worthless. Their foundation would be built on the sand, and storm and tempest would sweep away the structure. So I believe this is the strongest passage I found about apostasy in God's church. And you know, all that is written here, it's true. Though we like it or not, this is what is going to happen. We already live in this time. And I want us to see something. You know, did you heard of kingly power in God's church today? Do you know what that means, kingly power? When people look up to other people. What did Jesus say in the gospel? He says, whoever wants to be great, let him be the servant of him. So this kingly power is not coming from God. This is from Satan himself. And he wants to make people look up for men. But Christ is calling us to look where? To look at Jesus Christ, not at men. And the man cannot have any authority except he goes but thus says the Lord. Otherwise we are not to listen to men. And this time as it is coming, the Bible says, the spirit of prophecy says, the foundation will be built on the sand, not on the rock. Sand, it's man, it's not Christ. Christ is the rock. So when this time is coming, the storm and tempest will sweep away the structure. I believe this event is going to be fulfilled at the Sunday law. The structure will be completely removed. Because they did not listen to the word of God. I want us to see something. As we are speaking about this, you know that Paul was mentioning this time. Let's read verse 3 again. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. This falling away means apostasy. It's early apostasy and the apostasy that we experience today. So when this time is coming, there will be a falling away, the Bible says. And I want to remind you something. Let's go to Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18. I want us to read the passage here and understand why I speak about this in this way. Because we need to hear this message and we need to come in accordance to God's will. It's extremely important to understand this. In Matthew 18 verse 21, the Bible says, then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me? And I forgive him. Till 7 times. Now look at the answer of Jesus. Jesus said unto him, I say not unto thee until 7 times, but until 70 times 7. Why did Jesus reply to Peter 70 times 7? Could he say 75 times 7? He could say something else. Why did he say that? Because he was actually speaking in a prophetic language. And let's see what was he referring to. In Daniel chapter 9 verse 24, the Bible says 70 weeks were appointed to the people of God. So he was speaking about the close of probation for the Jewish nation. Let's go to Daniel chapter 9 in verse 24. We want to read this verse together. In Daniel chapter 9 verse 24, the Bible says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon the holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. So this was the time that was given to the people of God. So Jesus Christ, he knew that this time is coming to an end. The watch for the children of Israel was almost over. And they were about to come to the end of their probation. Are we living in a time when we come to the end of our probation?
Yes.
Is this near? Mm-hmm. So what is the message that we must hear in this time? You know, Jesus wept for the city. Mm-hmm. This is what the Bible says in Luke 19:41. He wept for them because he understood that they are in a dying spiritual condition. Mm-hmm. And we are in the same spiritual condition today. And we need a message which can prepare us for this time that is coming. Mm-hmm. We cannot be just come here and be entertained by anything, because we need to be prepared for what is coming. Amen. So I believe when Jesus was speaking to Peter, he was referring to the close of probation for Israel. So now our probation is nearing also. And I want us to go back to 2 Thessalonians. You know how close it is? It is very, very close. I want us to see this point and then we can pray together. 2 Thessalonians. We go back to 2 Thessalonians and we read from chapter 2. We are going to read now verse 3 again. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verse 3. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come the falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed. Who is the man of sin? The man of sin is actually papacy. It represents this system of papacy. But now look at what Paul says. The man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. I wonder why Paul calls this man of sin also the son of perdition. Did you know that in the Bible there are only two passages which speak about the son of perdition? Let's see the other passage. It's actually in John chapter 17 and verse 12. It's about Judas. Revelation 17 and verse 12. I want us to read together. Sorry, it's John chapter 17, actually, I think it's John 17:12, yeah, thank you. Let's read together. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Mm. Now, I want us to see something very important. But before we go further, I want us to see a short video clip, if possible. I want us to see something, and I want us to understand very clearly what does it mean when the Bible says the son of perdition. This is the son of perdition, the sin of man. The man of sin. Let's see this video clip shortly. I want us to see something. Do you remember when this Pope, new Pope, was elected? Pope Francis. Do you know that when this Pope was elected, this event took place at the Sistine Chapel, if I remember well. So when this event took place, all the people were watching it. But did you know that in the same time when he was elected, it was an election for the president of the Baptist Church? Did you know that? Why is it that people don't know about Baptist anything, but they know everyone knows about Papa? Why it is? Because the Bible says all the world shall wander after the beast. So all the world is wandering after this beast. And we want to see what is saying. We can see it. This clip will show us when this man was put in his position, what was he declaring, and why was he choosing the name first, Francis first, Francis the first. Let's see what they have to say about it. Because, you know, this name, Francis First, it comes from another name which is called Francis Assisi. Mm-hmm. And we want to see what this name represents. It's important for us to understand this. And as you are watching this clip, then I want us to conclude our message by understanding what is going to happen very soon into our world. Okay, we might soon see it. Until we can see this, we can actually go to John 13. Let's go to John 13. Because I want to make another point before we see this clip. John 13. We want to read here John 13, and let's read together from verse 14. If I then your Lord and Master have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord, neither that he that is sent greater than he that sent him. If ye know these things, happy are you if you do them. We remember this was the time when Jesus was sitting with the disciples at the Lord's Supper. Now look at what is happening here. After this, Jesus said, in verse 21, when Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in his spirit, and testified and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. What was he speaking about here? He was speaking about Judas. Judas was to betray Jesus. But look here what the Bible says in verse 22. Then the disciples looked one on another, doubting of whom he spoke. So the disciples, those who were the closest to Jesus, they did not understand what was Judas' plan. They looked up to Judas as a very respected person. And they thought that Judas is a respected person. They didn't want to believe that this man has something to do with the betrayal of Jesus Christ. Okay, we can see it now. If we can have some volume. It's okay. So if you can read this. Okay. Actually, there is no need for it because he speaks in Italian. So this is the translation. Okay, we want to look at it again. When the votes reached 2/3, there was the usual applause because a pope had been elected. Now I want you to see what he says about his name. Cardinal Humes hugged me and kissed me and said, don't forget about the poor. I want us to pay attention to this thing. Don't forget about the poor. And that word entered here, the poor. Now I want you to see why did he take this name. Francis was a man of peace. And that is how the name entered my heart. Francis of Assisi. So this is the man that was caring for the poor. The man who gave us this spirit of peace, the poor man. And how I would like a poor church for the poor. Okay, I think we can stop it here. I wanted you to see what does the mean of Pope Francis I means. He took this name because he wants to show a deep interest for the poor people. But now my question is, what has this to do with Judas? Do you know that when Paul calls Judas as being when Paul says that Judas is the son of perdition, and Paul says actually that the man of sin is the son of perdition. He was referring to Judas because there is a similarity between Judas and this Paul. And I want us to understand something. Let's read John 13 and verse 22. Then the disciples says, looked one on another, doubting of whom he spake. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. Simon Peter therefore beckoned unto him that he should ask who he should be of whom he spake. So the disciples, they did not understand why. Because they were looking at Judah as a respected person. They never thought that Judah could betray Jesus. And not only the disciples, even the multitudes, they never thought that Judah would be such a person. Actually, they thought that Judah is the one who cares for the poor. He's looking for the good of the people. And who was the one? Who was Judah actually? He was the one who was keeping what? The money. So he was the treasurer, we can say. So he was with the money. The question is, who has the control over the money of this world? It is the Pope. He is controlling everything. And you know, this crisis that we are in, this is a crisis that was provoked by the Pope. It is brought to us by the Pope himself because he's trying to draw people to himself. And now, if you look at this Pope, the actual Pope, Francis, did you see what this Pope is doing? When he goes, I heard that he went into prison, he washed the feet of the prisoners and he kissed them. Then he goes on the streets and he goes to the very poor people and he shows a lot of compassion. Why he does that? Why do you think he does that? He wants to gain the attention of people to him. But remember something. While Judah was caring for the poor, pretending to care for the poor, what was he doing behind? He was planning to betray Jesus. So when this man is doing this, he is actually preparing the persecution, and this time not Jesus, but the children of Jesus. I mean the people of Jesus. I want us to understand something very clearly. You know, this when I've seen this issue in the Bible, I understood something. Now I want us to bring this one to a close. And I want to refer back to the Garden of Gethsemane. You know, when this Pope was put in his office, in I think it was March or April, I don't remember exactly, this year, when he was put in the office, I believe that time the prophecies of the Bible and the example with Judas was fulfilled. You know that Judas' intention was not known to the disciples until the Lord's Supper. It was then when it was revealed. So if we have to take this one and apply it for the office that this Pope took in April this year, now I want us to see something. What happened after Judah left the room in that night? What happened? Jesus and his disciples, they went where? Into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. So it means when we see this Pope in his office, it's time for God's people to pray more than ever before, because the next event is the Sunday law. And I just want to make this point clear. You know, do you know what happened when the people were praying Jesus was praying in the garden? But do you know what happened then? The army, church and state combined, they came together to persecute God's people. So the next event after this Pope is installed, I mean, he may still die. It's possible that he may die and come another one. But as far as I believe now, I believe that this man, he is going to lead, to go to the Sunday law. He is going to pass the Sunday law, actually. Because this man had came in the position very decided. And he's decided to do things very seriously. I'm happy that our brother, he just mentioned here about this Pope that he's a Jesuit. And he has all the military force in his hands. You know, it's the first time in history when a Jesuit is elected as a Pope. So this is not a mistake. This is a prophecy fulfillment. And I believe that the next event that is coming up, it is the Sunday law, is upon us, is very close. So my question is, what are we going to do as God's people in this time? We need to be found in an experience of prayer. If we'll not be found in that experience, we'll have three options. And I want us to think, three options. It's either, when that time comes, we'll betray Jesus as Judah did. We can betray. And the spirit of prophecy says that our brethren who are among us, they will be the worst enemies against us. So this time is coming. We'll either betray our brethren. Then the second thing is that we'll flee from Jesus. You remember when the trial came, the disciples, they all flee from Jesus. They run from him. Why? Because they were not spiritually prepared. They did not spend time in prayer. Or the third thing is to remain faithful as Jesus did. But if we want to remain faithful and strong as Jesus was, we need to have the experience of Jesus in prayer. So I invite you this morning to think of these things. As we have seen the time in which we are living, we understand that we are coming so near to the close of probation. And we need to be cleansed from our sins. Not one sin is allowed to be in our lives. And by God's grace, in this afternoon, I want us to understand what this preparation means. You know, I just want us to understand. It makes no sense to give people information about prophecy and not give them the solution. So I want us to understand, how can we be ready for these events? And I pray that God will bless you this morning. Amen.
Amen. Amen.